Basically, all Americans know the Democratic and Republican Party. However, I'm pretty sure only some will know the minor parties of America. That's why I thought it could be interesting to do a video about America's third parties. As you can see, there have been many third parties in American history. However, in this video, I only want to talk about some current third parties. All those parties are active in the states, so I will not talk about parties in Puerto Rico. However, if people are interested enough, I might do a video about them. And yeah, you might be shocked to hear that many third parties have different strategies, and that most of them have pretty interesting histories. So let's start with the first party, which is the Libertarian Party. The Libertarian Party was founded August 1971. The founding of the party was a bit unusual, because the idea of the party was conceived after a number of meetings in the house of David Nolan. You probably haven't heard of David Nolan. However, you probably have seen the Nolan chart, which is still used as an alternative to the simple left-right divide. Nolan himself died in 2010 after a stroke. In 1978, Dick Randolph became the first person to be elected as a Libertarian. He had formerly been a Republican, but was elected to the Alaskan House of Representatives as a Libertarian. In office, he was for the repeal of the state income tax. This effort would be successful, and he served until 1982. In 1982, he would run for governor and would get a respectable 15% of the vote. He finished third after Democrat Bill Sheffield and Republican Tom Fink. Alaska also saw the best result of a Libertarian Party in a presidential election. In 1980, Ed Clark won over 11%. This was even enough to beat John Anderson, who was a strong independent candidate. However, Anderson would win 6.6% nationwide, compared to Clark's 1.1%. Members of the party consider the party more socially liberal than the Democratic Party, and more economically conservative than the Republicans. Ironically, outside of the US, the party would be seen as both socially and economically liberal. This is because deregulating the economy is seen as liberal in most other countries. They are actually more radical than most European liberal parties. This is because right libertarianism in the US is seen as right liberalism in a more extreme form in Europe. In the last decade, some legislators and especially Republicans have left their parties to join the Libertarians. The most famous of them was obviously Justin Amash, who was a member of the Nationwide House of Representatives. However, in 2020, a Libertarian was elected to the State Senate of Wyoming. Recently, the Libertarian Party has gotten more and more successful. You probably know that Gary Johnson is the most successful Libertarian candidate in a presidential election. In 2016, he got more than 3% of the vote. Meanwhile, John Hospas remains the only Libertarian candidate that got an electoral vote. In 1972, he actually got less than 0.01% of the vote, and only 3,674 votes in total. However, a faithless elector voted for him, and his vice presidential candidate Toni Nathan was the first woman in American history to get an electoral vote. Today, the party calls for a deregulation of the market, and is for a less powerful federal government. They are pro-LGBT rights such as same-sex marriage, and believe drug laws should be liberalized. Secularism, or the separation of church and state, is the core belief of the party. They are for open immigration, non-interventionalism, and neutrality in international conflicts. In 2018, the party openly was pro-sex work, and most in the party are pro-abortion, although some minority members such as Ron Paul are strictly against it. The Libertarian Party actually has state parties in each of the 50 states. This is actually pretty hard, as in some states it's very difficult for parties to register. If you think the Libertarian Party is too libertarian, I guess, you should look at the Green Party of the United States. The party is often abbreviated GPUSA, or just called Green Party. The GPUSA is actually a federation of green state parties, and split in 2001 from Green/Green Party USA. Yes, it's a bit confusing, but that was basically the predecessor organization and is now defunct. In 2002, John Adder was elected to the main House of Representatives as a Green Party member. He would be re-elected in 2004. In 2006, they had their best result in a gubernatorial election. In the state of Illinois, Rich Whitney got more than 10% and finished third after the Democratic and Republican nominees. In 2000, the Green Party got into a controversy, or I guess their predecessor, because many believed that Ralph Nader split the vote, and because of that Al Gore lost Florida. In the same election, Ralph Nader also was the only Green candidate ever to win more than 10% in a state. This was actually also in Alaska. Overall, he won 2.7% of the vote. Only 16 years later would any Green Party get more than 1%, this time under Jill Stein. Green parties were actually in several city councils and even had some majorities. but this was mostly in the 2000s. The party can generally be seen as left-wing and as environmentalist. I mean, what else did you expect from a green party? They are also a progressive democracy and are opposed to both capitalism and state socialism. Their 2020 nominee Harry Hawkins even identified as a libertarian socialist. Both the libertarians and the Greens have many members. The libertarians have over 600,000 and the Greens over 200,000. This seems actually like pretty much, until you see it in comparison to Democrats and Republicans. I hope you liked this very nice pie chart I did in like 10 minutes. If you love this blockbuster quality content, why don't you subscribe? I do more stuff like this, or even better stuff. I know I'm a good seller. And maybe like this video. The Progressive Party is somewhat different. No, not that Progressive Party. No, also not that Progressive Party. The Vermont Progressive Party. No, not that Progressive Party. Yeah, that Progressive Party. Most people probably haven't heard of the Vermont Progressive Party, but I can tell you that they are probably the most successful third party in the country. But remember, Bernie Sanders is from Vermont, and I think we now know why the party is so successful. Originally in 1981, a progressive coalition was formed. They supported Bernie Sanders. And finally in 1999 the Progressive Party was formed. Since then they have never had less than 4 members of the House of Representatives in Vermont. At the moment they have 7, as well as 2 senators. Most progressives have a double affiliation with the Democratic Party, and there are some Democrats that also have a progressive affiliation. They mostly act like a coalition. In 2020, David Zuckerman, a member of the Progressive Party, was the nominee for both parties. That was in the gubernatorial election against Viscott. But as you can see, he pretty much got destroyed. However, before that he was lieutenant governor. In 1991, Peter Clavel was elected mayor of Burlington by the Progressive Coalition. What is funny is that the Progressive Party is actually the third biggest party in the country. If you only look at the elected offices, it can be described as social democratic and progressive. They are in favor of single-payer healthcare and for better public transportation. They are very pro-LGBT and want to replace the minimum wage with a living wage. That would be tied to inflation. Another party that is quite opposed to the Progressive Party is the Conservative Party, or more correctly the Conservative Party of New York State. As is quite obvious from the name, the party is another regional party. They were founded in 1962. This was because the New York Republican Party was seen as too liberal. To understand the Conservative Party, you have to understand the voting system in New York. In New York, a system called fusion voting is used. This means multiple parties can nominate the same candidate. In the last presidential election, Joe Biden got 56% from the Democratic Party, but also 4% from the more left-leaning Working Families Party. And this is why some minor parties have more relevancy in New York. The Conservative Party was actually also formed to balance another party, which was called the Liberal Party, and was formed in 1944. In the 1965 governor's election, conservative candidate William F. Buckley won more than 13%. He was a prominent conservative author and commentator and finished behind the Republican and Democratic nominees. They would also run later elections, but only in 1973 they got more than 10%. Otherwise, they endorsed the Republican candidate. The same, however, can't be said for Senate elections. In 1970, James Buckley ran for the Conservatives. He was the brother of William F. Buckley, at least I assumed that, but it turns out he is actually still alive, at the insane age of 89. And before I show you the result, I want to tell you that this is not a joke. Buckley won as the candidate of the Conservatives and Independent Alliance. He defeated Richard Oettinger of the Democratic Party, and Charles Goodwin, who was a candidate for a Republican-Liberal coalition. Yeah, that election was pretty weird. In 1976 he would run again, this time as the combined Republican-Conservative nominee, but he lost to the Democratic-slash-Liberal candidate. However, he would later serve in the first Reagan administration. Some experts say that the Conservative Party was successful in moving the Republicans in New York to the right, and they helped them retaining a majority in the state senate, even as New York became more left-leaning. In modern times they are mostly endorsing Republicans, however only if they aren't too moderate. They didn't endorse pro-same-sex marriage Republicans. The two pro-same-sex marriage Republicans later lost their seats. Because of their results, they have held the Roe C position since 2010. This means they are always the third party on the ballot in New York. However, in 2020 they were surpassed by the Working Families Party and are now in Roe D. Buckley actually remained the last third party senator until 2006, when Joe Lieberman won for the Connecticut for Lieberman Party. However, Lieberman had never been a member of the party, and was considered an independent Democrat. The last party we are going to look at is the Constitution Party. They were formed in 1990 as the US Taxpayers Party. This was a response to George Bush raising taxes, even though he had famously campaigned on no new taxes.
Read my lips. No new taxes.
In 1999, the party was renamed to Constitution Party. It is described as paleoconservative, but is also seen as right-wing to far-right. They deny man-made climate change, but they also differ from other right-wing populists. They want to repeal the 17th Amendment, which means they are against directly elected senators. They also say that states' membership in the union is voluntary. They are very anti-social security and want to either lower or replace taxes. They are very much on the Christian right, even in cases of rape, and go as far as being anti-pornography. Unsurprisingly, they see the Bible as the final authority of law. Their biggest success easily was in the 2010 election for the governor of Colorado. There, Tom Tancredo got 36% and finished second after John Hickenlooper. Tancredo was a former Republican representative, and the Constitution Party even got major party status. However, Tancredo quickly rejoined the Republican Party and disappointed the leadership of the Constitution Party. They would not feature candidates in the 2014 election. Others were more successful than him. For example, former Republican Rick Gossett in the Montana House of Representatives as a Constitution Party member. He actually became the chair of the House Education Committee, even though the chamber was controlled by the Republican Party. In national elections, the party hasn't seen much success. They saw their best result in 1996, when Howard Phillips gained 0.19% of the popular vote. And we are at the end of this video. Making this video took almost 2 days, so I would be thankful for any support you could give me. And as there's really nothing to say at this point, bye.